Okay, another 2 minutes.10 AM already, so can we start now? Alright. Assalamualaikum and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I am Surveyor Dr. Shamsida Saidan Kadri, your moderator for today's session. For your information, this event is organized by Research Management Unit Faculty of Architecture, Planning and Surveying. So I would like to welcome you all to this FSPU Top Webinar PhD Sharing Session. So before we get started, allow me to introduce our speaker today, TS Dr. Rostam Yaman. Yeah. He is a senior lecturer at Center of Study for Interior Architecture, Faculty of Architecture, Planning and Surveying. He is a fellow researcher of Green Technology and Sustainable Development at Research Management Institute, UITM, as an Entrepreneurship Coordinator for Malaysia Academy of SME and Entrepreneurship Development, MASMED FSPU. He is also a research grant recipient of Excellent Grant UITM and also under Ministry of Education Malaysia. His PhD is Environment, Development and Sustainability from Chulalongkorn University, Bangkok, Thailand. He is a registered interior designer with Lembaga Architect Malaysia, members and corporate member of Malaysian Society of Interior Designer, and other qualification, he is a pegawai Kadet Kanan Pasukan Sukarelawan Simpanan Tentera Laut Diraja Malaysia, KD Sri Klang. All right. His area of expertise more to green technology, sustainable development, sustainable assessment criteria, post-occupancy evaluation, project management, corporate design, interior architecture, industrial design, furniture design, graphic design, fashion and popular culture, hotel design, building and material technology, and many more. All right. So without further ado, I would like to welcome to TS Dr. Rostam Yaman to deliver the presentation titled Post-Occupancy Evaluation Framework for Sustainable Urban Development. All right. Over to you, Dr. Rostam.
Okay. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman. I'm Rostam Yaman, the presenter for today's sessions. It's actually the first sessions for the Faculty of Architecture, Planning and Surveying UITM. So I will proceed to the slide presentations now. Okay, I completed my PhD somewhere 3 years ago. Actually, I'm doing a research on the post-occupancy evaluation framework or model for sustainable township or urban development. So actually, Madam Chairman already introduced me a bit earlier. But anyway, I will explain a bit about myself. My name is Rustam Yaman, and you can see my email there. Or probably you can line or WhatsApp me using my mobile number. Academics, I graduated in Diploma in Interior Design in Institut Teknologi Mara in Malaysia, Bachelor Honours in Three-Dimensional Design, Interior Architecture from Kent Institute of Art and Design, University of Kent in the UK. I do my Master's in Art and Design at the University Teknologi Mara, and my PhD in Environment Development and Accessibility in Chulalongkorn University in 2017. Working experience, I've been working in a few design companies, furniture manufacturer, and then I was also a lecturer for about 8 years in Malaysia Institute of Art, and now I'm serving as a lecturer in University Teknologi Mara. So I'm registered member of the Board of Architects Malaysia, Malaysia Institute of Interior Designers, and also Malaysia Board of Technologists. Okay, before I proceed with the slide, I'd like to introduce the important person who make my PhD journey successful. My main advisors in Chulalongkorn University, Ajahn Suwatana Tadaniti, the first advisors, and then the second advisors, Dr. Bharat Dahia, and my third advisors, which is my boss now, my dean, of Faculty Architecture Planning and Surveying, TPR Dr. Town Planners, Dr. Professor Town Planners, Dr. Jamalul Laili Abdullah, and also the collaborator for my case studies in Bangkok, Dr. Pim Supa Kok Chang. So I did my PhD in Environment Research Institute in Chulalongkorn University. Okay, so this is basically the content of my slide today. And like you can see in the picture, the image, that was my thesis. I mean, after all the hard work for 3 years, so it's what it turned out to be. Okay, the introductions. What is sustainable development at urban level suggests a well-balanced and broader specific requirements of inhabitants. It can be achieved at different steps and level in the urban developments, from inside out, for example, from the interiors to the buildings, to the neighborhoods, community, township, and also to cities. To enhance township sensibility, understanding on the buildings, the communal space within the development, and also the public infrastructure. So I explained a bit on the urbanizations in context of my studies. Basically, our planet experiencing prevalent upsurge, urban sprawl in the growth history. And then this phenomenon mainly took place in developing nations, like in South Asia, for example. In the year 2017, we have like 7.5 billion populations inhibiting the metropolises, and approximately 60 mega metropolises. This was quoted from CRAS 2015, suppose. City have become the center of concentrations of the human routine, so it leads to the immense consumptions of energy. So these urbanizations, urban conurbations, turn out to be the basis cause of making our society today, like the culture towards the mass productions, mass consumptions, and the result of these two mass dumping of the generated waste. And so like you can see in the images, world populations, I think it become a very big problems to the futures in the year 2100. It was estimated 11.2 billion populations, and then also the most populated or the most densest urban areas, Tokyo, Yokohama, even Kuala Lumpur is not listed here. In my PhD, basically, like, I try to look from the literature, or how I come up with my issues. I try to look from broader context and then narrow down, which is my case study in Malaysia and Thailand. So basically, in Chulalongkorn universities, we need to take 1 year, coursework. And most of the subjects are related to the United Nations Sustainable Agenda. Right? So everyone in the class supposed to like come up with the issues or problems in research in related to the World Sustainable Agenda. So I look into a few United Nations article or the agenda of the summits. And then also Sustainable Development Goal, for example, the our Common Future Report, right? Building industry accounts for 40% of energy consumptions. And then also a quotations from Dahia on the state of Asia cities. You inhabited 30% of the land mass and 60% of the populations in the Asia regions. And then also Agenda 21 Summit, a green built environment as the practice of creating using healthier and more resource efficient model, and SDG goal number 11, which is the most related to my study areas, SDG number 11, sustainable city and communities, actually to make cities and human settlement inclusive, safe, resilient, and also sustainable. Okay, in the context of the ASEAN region, since the 50s, ASEAN region experienced tremendous level of urbanizations with more than 1,000% rise. The expansion of city-based economic activities basically draw humans from rural area to the cities, and then also we consume a lot of natural resources. Thus, the urbanization process in the ASEAN region linked to economic growth rapidly in the rising consumptions. And so this is basically like acclimatized way how we live into the way of like instead of like the conventional way probably 15 years ago, most of the ASEAN region are like agricultural base. Now we more industrial and everybody like migrated to the cities, become the urban power of consumptions. So basically, it will raise the city demand for consumable, demand for developed land, demand for city expansions or urban sprawling. Finally, likely that such expansions of consuming class will spur demand for private vehicle, and then of course it lead to the further exacerbating climate change and worldwide impacts. So it happens in our regions. You can see in the images there, and the statistic in the cities, it rise 1,000% from 1950s, from 26 million populations to 294 million in 2040. Then I narrow down to the focus on Malaysia. So this is what is the concept of sustainable township. Is actually a livable place that meets the diverse needs of the community. In Malaysia, we have a sustainable rating system for urban development, which is we call GBI Township Assessment Criteria. It has been developed somewhere like 10 years ago. Been developed and implemented, but there is a lack of post-occupancy evaluation being conducted in assessing the effectiveness and accessibility level at the certified development plan. Basically, for my research problems, we have a township that being certified by the Green Building Council of Malaysia. But then the certification was done during the planning and then constructions up to the, what you call it, handover to the developers when the township is completed. So new township has a certified rating, sustainable rating. But then it stopped there. So my study basically tried to measure the accessibility level, right, to the end user or the homeowner or the household of the certified sustainable township or sustainable urban development. So basically we have accessible rating, we have sustainable townships, but we are lack of post-occupancy evaluations. Okay, why it is important to make this positive sustainability thinking trend to continue is that we should not only stop the, what you call it, sustainable practice at the developer's level. It's supposed to be continue up to the end user level in order to make the holistic sustainable agenda, right? So in order to do that, this particular project, the certified sustainable township, right, need to be evaluated to determine if the actual performance is in line with the predicted outcome. The idea is that because most of the township was designed by town planners, by the architects in designing the building, and probably interior designers designed the the interior, right? But then they predict or they visions how the city is going to be used, it's going to be look like. But at the end of the day, it's actually the end user or the homeowners or the property owners or the household basically will use it. And then of course, city also like a living organism, it grow, it can become sick and probably it can even become die. So basically my research want to gauge or measures after the urban development being certified, whether upon occupancy, I mean, it is still like within the level of the the score that they achieve during the development time. So basically, the GBI assessment criteria for township in Malaysia, right, they look into business and innovations, building resources, transportations and connectivity, community planning and design, ecology and environment, and also climate, energy and water. So basically in my research, the post-occupancy framework, I try to develop it using the accessibility dimension pillars, which I studied based on the United Nations Sustainable Agenda, which is include environmental stewardship, social responsibility, and also the economic prosperity. A bit about sensible neighborhood development or township development assessment criteria. So basically, I think worldwide, in fact, in each country, they have their own the sustainable township assessment criteria. In the table, you can see that. In UK, we have BREEAM, right? Last publication year 2012. And then we have LEED in the US, CASB in Japan, DGNB in Germany, and so on. So in Malaysia, we have assessment criteria for green township, which is under Green Building Index Malaysia. So this is some of the certified developments, urban developments in Malaysia. I mean, like this slide is actually was done probably 4 or 5 years ago. And during my studies, I think probably we have more certified township in Malaysia. But actually what I want to show in this slide from this 8 example of certified township Malaysia, so I took 3 of it as my case study, and I was requested by my advisors to do one regional case study in Thailand. Okay, the statement of the problems of my studies is actually whether the existing Green Building Index assessment criteria and certified project fulfill the effectiveness and sustainability criteria according to sustainability dimension pillar, which is SDP. SDP is actually consists of environment, social, and also economic. Hence, the objective of the research, number one, to identify and formulate post-occupancy evaluation model. The second one, to implement post-occupancy evaluation model to evaluate similarity and discrepancies of post-occupancy evaluation theory and variable, whether it's deeper from pre-occupancy assessment theory and variables, and also the objective number four, to recommend the adaptations of post-occupancy evaluation framework findings to similar developments in the regions and country throughout the world. Then to answer this objective, so I come up with also four research questions. The first one, how can the post-occupancy framework can be developed and implemented? What are the most significant sustainable urban framework criteria? Would and why theory of post-occupancy differ from pre-occupancy? And then how can this criteria be tested on the workability and also implemented through urban development project? And then towards the ending of the studies, when my third advisors was appointed, he requested to me to have a hypothesis. So I come up with two hypotheses. Number one, sensible dimension method will improve the accessibility within the community neighborhood context. And then the hypothesis number two, post-occupancy evaluation model assessment criteria and theory would differ from the pre-occupancy assessment criteria and theory. So this is basically my research conceptual framework. So the methodology that I use in the study is stakeholder inclusion approach. It's actually to gather the end user view and also experience on the proposed post-occupancy evaluation framework for sustainable urban development for the certified Green Building Index Township project. So in my case, in Malaysia and Thailand, is actually to address the research questions. Are the current certified Green Building Index neighborhood project in Malaysia sustainable enough? And basically, how to evaluate and assess the sensibility through the adapted dimensions of the framework. So basically, this is the framework of the studies. Like you can see in the presentations there. First, I do the content analysis and literature review. So basically, I look into the environment dimension pillar, sustainable dimension pillar, which is include the environment, economic, and also social. And then the second one, in order to develop the post-occupancy evaluation framework, I did the interviews. I did semi-structured interview with the expert. So they are basically the professional in the building industries, which range from urban planners, architects, designers, engineers, surveyors, and so on. Basically, I try to develop, so try to find out what is the best or most suitable environmental, social, and economic indicators in the framework. And then the third one, I do the assessment criteria for sustainable neighborhood developments. So basically, I try to look into, because my studies is actually the certified the certified township developments. And I look into GBI Malaysia, Green Building Index Malaysia criteria versus sustainable dimension pillar, which include the environment, social, and also the economic indicators. And then the fourth one, so where I get the data from the current sensible urban development in Kuala Lumpur, I draft the framework, and then I did the expert interviews. I try to get their feedback on the frameworks, and then I do quantitative data. they try to find out the sensible dimension pillar adaptations in the Green Building Index Township Assessment Criteria. I also gather the demographic data, and then I do the end user survey, and then also professional stakeholder survey. And then my case studies, Ken Rimba development in Shah Alam, in the Klang Valley, and also new development of the Rimba Yu Township and also Sunway Resort City. And then I was requested towards the ending of the studies, one regional case studies, because my advisors want to test whether my handbook is workable or not. So I did one regional pilot studies, which was done by my collaborator, Dr. Pim Supa Kok Chang, in Parinyada village in Bangkok. So with all the data, then I did the tests and evaluations, and I did the implementations. And once my pilot study for my handbook was sort of like validated, so the output of the research are basically a handbook for post-occupancy evaluation model for sustainable township development. Okay, so this is basically the case study, the Malaysia case study. Ken Rimba was certified sustainable township, and Bandar Rimbayu Township was certified as silver. And then Sunway Resort City also certified as silver green township. And then I also did one case study. I mean, of course, the Thailand case study, I mean, was not certified by Green Building Index Malaysia. But anyway, I tried to find the most similar developments in Thailand, which can be tested using this post-occupancy evaluation framework handbook. Okay, this is actually very important things. I mean, I can see the participants today look like most of them is actually a postgraduate students. So my advice throughout my journey for 3 years in Chulalongkorn University, Bangkok, Thailand, you really need to do this your milestone activity, and really need to follow it. So basically my first years in Chulalongkorn University, I take 9 modules. It's compulsory to take 9 modules, so it took 1 year. And after that, I sit for qualifying exam. During the second semester, the ending of the second semester, and then I produce one publication, ARPN Journal Publications. And then my proposal examinations, so research proposal defense, towards the ending of the third semester. But anyway, it was postponed because I think my program director attended one United Nations conference in the France, in Paris, I think. And then my proposal examination, or the defense research proposal, was conducted in my 4 semesters. And then once I passed my proposal examinations, then I start to really work on my my thesis, my research proposal. So I did a few publications, I applied grant, I attend a lot of conferences, and then but you really need to follow strictly because I received a scholarship from the government of Malaysia. I only have 3 years to do it, so by hook or by crook, you need to get it done. And luckily I get a very nice, super nice first advisors. So she asked me to work backwards, when I supposed to finish. Then from there, we try to arrange when I supposed to do VIVA or thesis examinations, and then to submit the first draft, and then so on backwards. So you really need to really follow this the milestone activities, and then after I finish my thesis examinations, I got lucky that I got ASEAN 50 Congress in Manila. I mean, like the accommodations and the etiquette was sponsored by, I think, by the government of the Philippines. But of course, at that time, the viva was done. The thesis examination is done. So I presented my work, my thesis in Manila. And then after that, I come back to Malaysia. I mean, report for DP, and that's it. And so it was a solid 3 years PhD. So another thing which is I found it like quite interesting when I do my thesis viva, my second advisors, which is Dr. Bharat Dahiya, he really helped me a lot in discuss to prepare myself for the thesis examinations or viva. So he told me to prepare the slide based on the research objective, questions and finding instead of doing separately. Okay, so this is my RO and RQ1, right? RO1, to identify and formulate post-occupancy evaluation model based on sustainable dimension pillars towards sustainable urban developments for Malaysia. So basically, if you see in the I'm not sure whether you can see this cursor or not, right? The center model, right? Where you can see the word POEM or POEM. Right? So from here, I studied the content analysis. I studied the Green Building Index Malaysia, all the criteria. So basically, there is 52 assessment criteria to certify or to measure or to evaluate green township in Malaysia. So from there, I try to synthesize it with the sustainable dimension pillar, which is environment, economic, and social. Right? So a lot of factors that you need to look into, for example, in terms of the psychologically factors, social factors, human factors, and then loading, use of resources, production, so waste, odors, noise, and so on. And then I develop it and come up with this this conceptual framework. And then I presented interviews the expert in order to verify this model. So finally, I come up with this table, how to measure the post-occupancy evaluation for sustainable township developments to the end user and also the homeowners or household in the certified township development. The thing is that the Green Building Index Township Assessment Criteria is very technical, basically. So I try to make it like look... much more, I think, like suitable or easier for the normal people or the layman to understand. So I come up with this basically 24 assessment sub criteria instead of 52 from the Green Building Index Township Assessment Criteria. So it was divided into three. We have environment dimension pillar, social dimension pillar, and also economic dimension pillar. So from there, I developed the handbook so that my collaborator or my research assistant in Malaysia can conduct survey the homeowners or the household or the end user of the certified green township. So basically, this is procedures, how it was conducted. First one, identify and select case studies, and then gather information and setting up survey questionnaire and database bank, because I use basically a simple Google form. And then the third one, conduct the surveys, collect the data from the end user or the household. And then the fourth one, did the analysis, and then you get the findings, and then you do the evaluation outcome or the report. So basically in the handbook, it explains everything basically, or even how to compile the report. So I did some population sampling, but this is a very simple one using Yamane sampling method. Basically how many respondents for each township developments. And then the rating benchmarking was similar, same one which used by the Green Building Index Malaysia. And then basically the scoring for my framework is basically 1 to 5. So basically, for example, in environmental pillar question number 1, sufficient designated green area. So we ask the homeowners or the end user of that particular township to give the score, whether it is like highly sufficient or one score for very less sufficient, for example. So that was basically how that particular post occupancy evaluation framework was developed. Was based on the expert's opinion, or it was verified and validated by the expert. And then for research questions and also research objective number 2, to implement this post-occupancy evaluation model or framework in assessing and evaluating GBI certified township, the research questions: what are the most significant sustainable urban framework criteria, and how this criteria can be tested in order to see the workability and implemented through the urban development project. So basically based on the data or the feedback from the experts. So I use all these questions. And then the findings, experts were in agreement basically with all the sub-criteria I use in order to do the post-occupancy evaluation framework. And of course, you can see number there, the p-value, all the 3 starting, which is significance. For these studies, besides SPSS test, I also use structural equation modeling, which you see in the slide discussed in chapter 6. It's actually it's the original slide I presented during my thesis examinations. Okay. So this is actually the result for the RQ2 and the findings, case study number 1 in Kenrimba. So basically, this is the demographic data. Basically, I try to know whether they understand or not what is sustainable urban development. I also asked the end user whether they understand what is sustainable dimension pillar. Are they aware whether the township that they occupy is certified green? And then what is their role, whether they are homeowners or tenants or workers? And then basically the durations when they stay there, whether the tenants, normally they say temporary, and then homeowners probably like longer stay in this. I mean, that kind of thing. And then basically for the Kenrimba, there is 4 criteria fail to fulfill POEM rating, which is like the score basically less than half of the full score. And then there is 2 good POEM score rating. And this is for my second case study in Rimbayu Township. So basically they have 3 outstanding score, or 1 beyond outstanding, and then we have basically like nearly 8 fail to fulfill POEM rating, which is I can explain to you earlier what is the thing that can be improved. And then the case study number 3 is actually Sunway Resort City, right? So same cases also. So we have 6 or 7 fail to fulfill the post-occupancy evaluation framework rating, and then 3 outstanding score, right? So it depending on the developments. For example, like the Bandar Rimbayu is actually a very new township, and then the development itself might take 25 years to complete. So when I conducted the case study, they just finished. first phase, probably some of the transportations, public transportations are not really in place. So I think that's why probably the score lower compared to the other two case study. And this is like my case study, regional case study in Parinyada village in Bangkok. I mean, the score is basically the outstanding and the fail score is almost equal. The outstanding one, for example, here number two, environmental pillar question number two, sufficient streets or lighting park. So basically based on the end user opinion and experience, so they found it good, then probably they give 5 score, then we total together all the the respondents feedback, then that was the total score. Okay, for the research objective and question three, is actually to evaluate similarity and discrepancies post-occupancy, whether it's deeper from pre-occupancy, and would NY theory of post-occupancy differ from pre-occupancy. So this one, based on the total result achieved, from the on-site testing process, have emphasized that pre-occupancy assessment criteria and theory differ from the post-occupancy. So meaning that here, whatever that being visioned by the planners or by the architects when they developed the township and it was certified before the occupancy, is actually different when it being used by the end user. So basically, out of 3 case studies in Malaysia, only one achieved, meaning that they got the similar score between pre-occupancy and post-occupancy, while the other two townships, which is Bandar Rimbayu or Rimbayu Townships, and also Sunway Resort City, they did not achieve. Meaning that the score, that because I used the same rating benchmark by GBI Malaysia, the pre-occupancy assessment criteria, GBI Township assessment criteria. So the score after post occupancy is actually lower than what it being being they achieve when they do the pre-occupancy or during the development certifications. Same modeling findings suggested that there is distinct value of score generated. Phase 2 pre-occupancy standard regression weight value is highly significant. Phase 3 post-occupancy standardized regression weight also below significant level. So therefore, post-occupancy evaluation model assessment criteria and theory would differ from the pre-occupancy. Thus, this hypothesis is supported. So this is basically some number and diagrams about the phase 2 and phase 3 of my research analysis. The same modeling findings suggested there are distinct value of score generated in every standard for variable, and so basically the average standards for construct and variables, so the probability values, significance, hence both of these research questions supported. Okay, and finally, the research questions and also research objective number 4, right, to recommend the adaptations of post-occupancy findings to similar development phenomenon in the regions and the country throughout the world, right? From the sustainable neighborhood development, or in Malaysia we call it sustainable township developments, to country level green building institutions. As far as I know, I think all country have their own green building institutions. For example, Thai Green Building Institutes, we have Singapore Green Building Council, Philippines Green Building Council, and so on. And pre-occupancy, basically in Malaysia, we have 6 core criteria: energy, water efficiency, environment, ecology, conservation, community trust, transportations and connectivity efficiency, material resources efficiency, and also business and innovativity. And so I simplified this and do the household survey right, based on the using the sustainable dimension pillars, which is the environment, conservations and preservations, and then social pillar, equity and justice, and economic pillar using the innovations and also efficiency. So the implementations of the post-occupancy evaluation model will benefit the first one, the most important thing, continuing sensible development agenda, which is from pre-occupancy certifications to post-occupancy when that particular township or the urban development was occupied by the end user. Nurturing sensible practice at all level, conurbation to township, to neighborhood, to community and to individual. Because most of these, sustainable criteria, like I mentioned to you earlier, the green assessment criteria for township in Malaysia is pretty technical. I believe people who are not really into it, it's pretty difficult to understand it, and somehow it has 52 sub-criteria. And so, I mean, whatever that being implemented before pre-occupancy, which is good, but then when the developments, I mean, when people bought the property or stay in that particular development, by right, it's supposed to be, it's supposed to be continual, to be honest, in order to make this, the sustainable urban development agenda continue. Specific sensible dimension criteria and sub-criteria, simplified and easily comprehend at all levels. So this one, when I give to collaborator in Thailand, so she basically conduct the whole thing and then come out with this, the findings, and then she can even like write the report based on the handbook that I produce. I mean, the output of the studies applicable to any post-urban neighborhood or developments. Okay. Research conclusions, hypothesis one, whether sensible pillar dimension method will improve the sensibility within the community, the same modeling findings in my thesis, I suggested the SDP gap in evaluation criteria. So, I mean, of course, when there is a gap, meaning that the post-occupancy evaluation model, can trace, I mean, whatever the gap between pre and post. So therefore, there is a room improvements and enhancements upon post occupancy. So I mean, definitely it can improve the post accessibility upon post occupancy. Hence, SDP method will improve accessibility, and this hypothesis is supported. And then hypothesis two, whether it's differ post occupancy model and pre occupancy assessment criteria based on on-site testing findings, sensitivity levels differ. Thus, it concluded that POEM assessment criteria and theory would differ. And then this hypothesis too is also supported. So the conclusions, the finding indicates that the comprehensive stakeholder approach method supported by the key issue of sensible dimension pillar, which is the economic, social and also environment, guided by clear comprehensive POEM handbook procedure. One interesting thing, so when I study in Bangkok, is that to graduate or when you to finish your studies, they want something which can be used, the output of the studies, I mean, not only theory. And then can oversee and foster the neighborhood development and community of Greater Kuala Lumpur region particularly, and also ASEAN region, because like we have a similar climatic and also geographic conditions generally towards an enhanced, balanced and holistic accessibility. Okay, this one is actually my thesis abstract. Okay, so thank you. That's all. Thank you from me. So I think we can open for Q&A sessions.
Okay. Alhamdulillah, thank you very much, Dr. Rostam, for the informative and interesting talk. Okay, now I open to question and answer session. Any participant that want to ask a question, you can put the question at the chat box or just unmute your mic and ask. Okay, thank you. Any question? location. Everybody understand.
So we got 70 people.
Alhamdulillah.
And no questions. Doctor. Okay. Okay, let me open this chat box. Doctor, is there any difficulties during collecting data from occupants? This is actually because the thing is that the certified green township in Malaysia, the property normally is much more expensive than the conventional township. And of course, the homeowners or the tenants or the household, their income group are more high class. So it's definitely very difficult when collecting data from the occupants. I've found a way how to overcome it. One way I did, of course, I need to hire research assistants in order to gather the data. So one thing I did, lucky me also, the person who are in charge, for example, in the Ken Rimba developments, the guy who helped me collect the data is actually used to work there before. So basically, he got the access to go to that particular developments. Probably the managers or the security people over there. So I managed to get respondents from the developments. And then same case also with Rimbayu Township. It's a new development, so I happen to have friends who are staying there. So he helped me a lot in order to gather the data. And I think if I want to knock door to door each of these, the occupants of the green township, I think it's almost impossible for me to complete my PhD in 3 years. And then for another case study in Sunway Resort City. Sunway Resort City, I do part-time teaching in Taylor's Lakeside Universities. So I have a lot of students who are staying in Sunway, right? So this group of people helped me a lot in order to gather the data from the respondents. And of course, for my Bangkok case study, the regional case study in Bangkok in Parin Nyada village, the collaborator is actually staying there. So she told me that she might do one function at the clubhouse of that particular the neighborhood. So she gathered the data from there. A lot of difficulties if the question is, but then I think once you have the timeline activities, you just need to get it done. Okay, other question can just lie on the mic.
Dr. Rustam can refer to the chat box.
I need to scroll down. Okay, sorry. Okay, PL Wang, awesome presentation assessment. What is your opinion on Michael Renault Earthshape sustainable design that can be adopted in these tanks? Okay, PL Wang. Honestly, I haven't read about this Michael Renault Earthshape sustainable design that can be adopted in this. So probably I cannot really answer your questions, but I mean, like for any sustainable what do you call it agenda, we of course we have United Nations who basically like governs or try to make this world sustainable. So they come up with the sustainable development goals, and then they have so many sub agencies under them. Right, for example, like UN Habitat, and then United Nations Environmental Programme, and so on. So I believe, I mean, whatever that being mentioned by Michael Reynolds, I think yeah, probably they can adopt this, right? Because to make the end user understand how that particular development is certified. I mean, how we gonna measure whether that development is green or not? It is very important because the sustainability, I mean, like green practice or sustainable practice started with you. I mean, if you as an individual know how to practice green, you know how the township or development being certified green, what criteria being used. For example, as far as I know, all sustainable, I mean, all green township criteria, basically, I mean, the main criteria is actually the energy efficiency. So as an individual, if you know how to save energy, so basically you are like promoting the continuations of the sustainable township agenda. Then from individual, probably to family, to community, and then of course the whole township. And then Dr. Arniatul Aiza, how do you relate this POE urban to interiors? Okay, like I mentioned to earlier, right, how this post-occupancy evaluation urban to interior is that, I mean, the larger unit is actually, we call it like an urban development or a city narrowed down to a township and probably to what do you call it, community, and then or neighborhood, and then to an individual. So basically these components of urban developments, if you see in terms of the materiality, it consists of the infrastructure, outdoor facilities, and also the buildings. And then of course when there is a building, and definitely there is an interior, and like I mentioned to all of you guys earlier, is that it doesn't matter how good the pre-occupancy or the certifications at developer levels, but then if the homeowners or the end user of that particular certified township are not aware or didn't know how this sustainable development criteria was certified, so it is useless. So from the larger unit, we narrow down to the most smaller unit. I mean, for example, like the whole populations to, to the community, to the family, to the individual, same thing also from large city to a buildings and probably the interior and probably sub rooms of the interior and so on. So I think it's very, very related. And then for the answer, okay.
Okay, any question?
Okay, other questions?
Okay, no question? Right, so ladies and gentlemen, finally, we come to the end of our session. I would like to say thank you again to our speaker, Dr. Rostam Yaman, for the informative and interesting talk. All right. Hopefully, the presentation will be beneficial for everybody. Okay. So thank you again for joining us. And don't forget to fill attendance form at the chat box. All right. Assalamualaikum and thank you very much. See you again.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Dr. Rostam tolong fill juga apa attendance form ya.
Ah, okay, okay.
Sebab nanti boleh terus hantar sekali. Thank you. Dr. Har juga, thank you. Dr. Har tolong fill attendance form, thank you.